On LCTV News.
Spring has sprung, and that means road construction. Major changes are in store for traffic on the south side of Dubuque.
City Council votes on spring-loaded replica guns inside city limits.
We are finding that they're used quite frequently for doing criminal mischief throughout the city.
And same-sex marriage debate moves to the Supreme Court. We have local coverage just ahead.
You're watching LCTV News, delivering you Dubuque.
This week, the Iowa Department of Transportation started a major construction project on Highways 52, 61, 151. Good evening, I'm Sarah Rochford.
And I'm Matt Resnick. This road construction project is expected to take about 2 years to complete. During this time, it'll affect the following areas of the highway. Beginning just north of the Grandview exit onto 52, 61, 151 and extending just south of the Twin Springs Road intersection. Phase 1 will target this intersection in the southbound lanes, while Phase 2 will focus on northbound lanes. LCTV's Maria Adolphs is live at the Grandview exit to give us more details on this project. Maria?
That's right, Matt. Construction started on the highway this past Monday, and as you can see behind me here, both directions are down to one lane on the highway. I was able to speak to one traffic engineer here in Dubuque this week, and we discussed the project and the different phases. If this is your morning commute, you may need to find an alternate route into Dubuque. The 5261 151 construction project starts with phase one, and that means improvements to the main intersection, which crosses with Twin Valley Drive.
They're going to be widening the pavement, putting in this left turn bay to go on to 52 South. So I think it's going to be the most painful this first couple of months while this is under construction.
After the completion of the intersection, the on-ramp from Grandview Avenue for southbound traffic will be closed around the 1st of May.
They're going to rebuild the roadway. They're going to do some slope stabilization because it's some pretty steep slopes in that river area. They're going to rebuild both Catfish Creek bridges.
It's obvious the construction will impact traffic in the area, but what are the best times to avoid construction?
In the afternoon, too, there's a really pretty heavy peak traffic taking a left to go back south onto 52. So those folks may want to see if they can find some alternate ways.
Even though the project will cause traffic concerns with lane closures at heavy traffic times, the city feels the project is important for the safety of the Dubuque community.
Anytime you're doing these kind of projects, it requires a lot of patience. But in the end, you know, it'll be a much improved roadway, a lot safer to drive on.
Reporting for LCTV News, I'm Maria Adolphs.
As Maria said, this is phase one of the project, which is set to be completed by the end of this year. Through the winter, all lanes will be open again, and construction of the phase two will resume next spring. For more information on this project, visit cityofdubuque.org.
The Dubuque City Council has voted to prohibit the carrying and firing of spring-loaded replica guns.
People will still be able to use these, but they won't be able to be knuckleheads about it.
The decision was made at Monday's meeting to limit the usage after local law enforcement has seen an increase in the usage of such replica guns in the community.
In that capacity, they are being used to intimidate others.
The vote was a unanimous 7-0.
On March 25th, Mayor Buell gave his 7th annual State of the City address. Serving his third term as mayor for the city of Dubuque, Buell strives to engage every citizen as a partner in addressing the needs of Dubuque community, such as public transit, water quality, and sustainability. Last week, the mayor acknowledged the accomplishments of Dubuque as he leads the city into the 21st century. He also brought up successes in the local colleges and their impact on the community, along with stating that Dubuque was voted one of the top places to live. The mayor also highlighted the city's development with the B Branch Creek restoration, which is serving as a sensible investment for the local taxpayers.
Dubuque businessman Rod Bloom announced his candidacy for the Republican nomination to Congress from Iowa's 1st Congressional District. This will be Bloom's second run for office after running in the 2012 Republican primary, ultimately losing to Ben Lang.
Same-sex marriage is a controversial topic that started in Iowa and has made it all the way to the Supreme Court. I take a look at some of the key issues at the heart of this debate and talk to a couple of professors at Loras College to hear both sides of the issue.
After hearing arguments from both sides late last month, Supreme Court justices are now contemplating the issue of gay marriage. But as they deliberate their verdict in private, the debate continues to rage on for the public as society has become largely more accepting of same-sex couples.
I've seen a great shift in the last 10 years, especially. And I think it comes from mostly from the youth, that we're growing up in a society that no longer demonizes people.
One of the factors has been the media has played a huge role.
A wave of support for gay rights overtook social networks as hundreds of thousands of users changed their profile pictures to a red equal sign.
Facebook turned red, and I thought that was interesting, the arguments for that and against, saying, oh, you're slacktivist.
However, not all are so convinced that the term marriage should be extended to gay couples.
I would be more comfortable calling it something other than marriage. And civil unions is good enough.
Although the public may have differing opinions on the issue, the Supreme Court will make their final decision on the matter in late June.
Dubuque Community School District is requiring students between the ages of 10 and 14 to receive the whooping cough vaccination before beginning the 2013-2014 school year. The whooping cough, also known as pertussis, is a bacteria caused by respiratory disease that has serious effects, especially on small children. In the next few months, Dubuque schools will be planning to administer the shots for free. After the break,
local nonprofits gather to help make connections.
The Pope presided over his first Easter Mass as Pontiff.
And Girl Scout camps will reopen again for the summer.
They said
if I got drunk,
if I did coke,
I'd be one of the guys.
They said meth would help me get through my exams.
They said sniffing glue was no big deal.
Totally safe.
I could party all night.
They said heroin would be the best high I ever had.
It would help me forget my problems.
He said he'd love me forever if I smoked crack with him.
They said I wouldn't get hooked after the first hit.
They said that Ritalin would help me focus.
They said weed wouldn't lead to harder drugs.
He lied.
Find out the truth. The truth about drugs.
Drugfreeworld.org.
Drugfreeworld.org.
Need some quick cash for spring break or a new warmer weather wardrobe? Well, in this installment of The Stretch, Thomas Graziano will show you three quick ways you can make money right here in the tri-states.
The past few shows, I've been showing you how to budget your money wisely. But what if you have no money to begin with? If you keep ending up at one of these every time you want to go out, and it's a good thing you tuned in this week to The Stretch.
First up, say hello to your one-stop shop for a free lunch. You know all those cans you've been collecting in bags because you keep missing garbage day? Bring them down to the Center for Recycling and get 5 cents a piece for them. 100 cans, $5, 5 McChickens. Simple. Or if soda isn't your thing, you can always bring all your hand-me-downs to Hut Number 8. They'll pay you cash in your hand for old clothes, as long as they're in good shape.
Let's say it's a polo from Polo. Okay. We sell them for $16. Therefore, we can give you about $4.80 for them. We give you 30% of what we can sell it for.
Now, that's not too shabby, but BioLife Plasma Services is definitely the place to go if you're trying to save up for something big. It's quick, clean, and you can bring your kids.
The first time does take a little longer. It's about a 2.5 hour process, but then every time after that, it's about an hour, a little 60 to 70 minutes.
2 hours a week is not a lot of time to commit. And wait till you hear these deals.
It's $50 on their first donation and $50 on their second donation. So $100 in two donations. After that, it's $20 on your first donation for the week, $30 on the second for the week. Well, every month we change it up. So, but $20, $30 is usually our base fee.
So remember to recycle, clean those old shirts, and help save a life. You might just earn some cash doing it.
Now, Matt, Tom will be giving his a break from The Stretch, and he's going to be trying out the Loras College drum line and seeing the skills that he's got there.
Well, you know, that'll be interesting. I've always known Thomas to be someone to march to the beat of his own drummer. Members of a local nonprofit organization gathered this morning at the Diamond Joe Casino for the monthly Community Connections meeting. The meetings consisted of various Dubuque nonprofit organizations working to develop their programs into successful establishments. The event featured Jim Collins, president of Loras College, and he spoke to us about the event and supporting the Dubuque community.
One of the things I've benefited from in life is having lots of mentors and lots of people who are generous with their time, and so to the extent that I can do that, for others in some small or meaningful way, I think is a good thing.
The Community Connections meeting takes place the first Wednesday of every month. For more information, visit the Dubuque City of Commerce webpage.
Big changes are taking place out in the arterial as Old Navy plans on closing its doors in the Asbury Plaza. The store, which was one of the first to open in the plaza, is now closing to note details being released by Old Navy in regards to this decision. A possible factor playing into the decision could be an uncertainty of the Shoppers Center's future due to the financial struggles since January 2012. The store is said to be closing at the end of this month.
Now to Vatican City, where just a couple of weeks ago a new pope was elected. Easter celebrations took place this weekend with 250,000 people packed into Vatican Square celebrating Pope Francis's first Easter as pontiff. His thoughts were expressed through a caring message addressing conflict in the Middle East to parts of the world in need of help. After the speech, Pope Francis rode through the crowds wearing cream-colored vestments and greeting worshipers, shaking hands, and even embracing a disabled child being held out to him in the crowd.
Due to much resistance from camp supporters, the Girl Scouts of Eastern Iowa and Western Illinois have announced to not sell their summer camps. Camp Little Cloud, which is just outside of Epworth, will now be open this coming season, and there are plans for renovations to the site. The camp will be used to host overnight and daytime activities for girls of all ages, and improvements to the existing facilities will include adding a nature trail and adventure hikes.
The National Mississippi River Museum is asking for help after it was discovered yesterday that a turtle was reported missing from their exhibit. The turtle is an adult leopard tortoise named Cashew. Officials for the museum are concerned that the turtle has been stolen, and Dubuque Police Department is investigating. If you have any information, please contact the museum and aquarium.
Spring is in the air and golfing season is right around the corner. LCTV spoke with several golf courses in the Dubuque area this week, and many say they are working diligently outside to be open in the next couple weeks. The cold weather and snow may have prolonged the golfing season a little bit, but with temps in the 60s this weekend, things are about to change. Specifically at Bunker Hill, we talked to Jerry, a grounds crew member, and he says that the course could be open as early as this weekend. Up next, Nina Mack brings you your Tri-State Sports Fix.
Stay tuned. After the break, we've got highlights from Clark Baseball versus Viterbo. We'll take a look at the Saints pre-playoff buzz, and we'll bring you a live update from the Loris versus UD softball game.
What do you guys want to do?
I don't know. What do you want to do?
I don't know. What do you want to do?
1, 2, ready, go. Gonna pull the stops, gonna make it go. You're living on a wing and a prayer. Gonna put them legs together. You know it's now or never.
They said if I did coke, I could party all night. They said if I did coke, I could party all night. They lied. Find out the truth about cocaine. Drugfreeworld.org.
Last week, the Loris College softball team left the cold Midwest and headed down to Clermont, Florida to play in the NTC spring games for their spring break. They ended up winning 6 out of 9 games while having a 5-game winning streak in the middle of the week. They defeated SUNY Postdam, St. Olaf College, SUNY Onieta, St. Catherine University, Grove City College, and Colby College. They only lost 3 out of the 9 games, losing to Duval College, Wisconsin Stevens Point, and College of St. Benedict. Overall, this was a great turnout for the Duhawks, helping them to an overall record of 7-6. Loras took on the University of Dubuque in a softball doubleheader today. The games were moved to the Dubuque Girls Independent League softball complex due to field conditions. UD lit up the scoreboard first, going up 2-0. Loras had something to say about that, scoring three unanswered runs in the second inning. Beth Miller earns an RBI and brings in Michaela Hassey to tie the game. A bases-loaded walk for Regan Teese forces in the run. Schnadler scores. Duhawk ties it at 2. Shelby Perkins scores an on-sacrifice fly by Katie Serpico. Duhawks up 3-2. Beth Miller tries to add to the lead but is tagged out at home. UD's Laura Mangana bats in the first of what would be three more runs for the UD. The Spartans take a game, 1-6-3.
We came out really strong, ready to win. And, you know, game of softball, some hits, just you need the clutch hits and the clutch runs, and we just couldn't follow through on that first game.
Game 2 actually just ended, and we have Caitlin Gerken live from the field to tell us more.
Hey, thanks, Nina. Holly Klein started this one for the Duhawks, but it wasn't enough, and Beth Miller led the team with two hits, but Amber Meyer of UD hit a home run to enforce the slaughter rule. Loras lost 11-2. They dropped both games of this doubleheader. That puts them at a losing record of 7-8 on the season. Nina, back to you.
Thanks, Caitlin. Teresa Kay announced late yesterday that she will be resigning as the head Loras College volleyball coach. Kay has been the head coach for the past 7 years for the Duhawks and has led the team to 2 Iowa Conference championships and a bid to the NCAA Division III tournament in 2008. Kay will now serve as the head volleyball coach for Linmar High School alongside teaching physical education. Clark Baseball took the field against the Viterbo V-Hawks yesterday. Although wet conditions postponed the game for 2 hours, finally the field was ready for baseball. After Viterbo scored 4 times in the first 3 innings, Clark returned with a base hit from Jordan Cameron to bring in the first run for the Crusaders. Clark could only cash in 1 run and could not hold off the V-Hawks as number 23 Ben O'Reilly pitched a stellar last 5 innings, racking up 3 strikeouts and 7 innings pitched. Viterbo wins this one 5-1. Clark was back on the field this afternoon and will play again tomorrow at Ashford University. With only 2 weeks remaining in the regular season, the Fighting Saints are looking to finish strong heading into the playoffs. The team has already clinched the Eastern Conference title, but the remaining 4 games have major implications. They are currently 7 points ahead of Sioux Falls for the Anderson Cup, which is awarded to the USHL regular season champion. Also, with a win on Friday against the Waterloo Blackhawks, they will repeat Cowbell Cup champions, a 3-way competition between Dubuque, Waterloo, and Cedar Rapids. This past week, the Saints also voted for the team's annual awards. Mike Zmatula was voted MVP by his teammates after leading the league with 37 goals. Zmatula also led the team with 75 points this season. Now for the result of our very own LCTV NCAA Tournament Bracket Challenge. Allie Elwood and myself are tied for first with 120 points. I think this is pretty good for me, seeing as I just guessed. Following us is Eric Osborne with 116 points, and right behind him, our professor Craig Schaefer rounds out the top 3. The final 4 is this Saturday, with Louisville playing Wichita State and Michigan facing off against Syracuse. The championship game will be Monday night, so be sure to tune in to Sports Zone next Wednesday when we reveal our winner. That's all we have for sports shorts. Back to you, Matt and Sarah.
Man, I don't know about you, but I'm pretty proud of myself that I didn't end up in last place.
Well, yeah, you certainly did better than I did. I kind of dropped the ball this year. The Julian Dubuque International Film Festival is back again this weekend. This year, the event is showcasing 60 films within the span of 4 days. These films will be shown at venues such as Lot 1, The Hub, Hotel Julian, and Vinnie Vannucci's. This year's honorary chair member is actor Gary Busey. The kickoff party takes place Thursday. Tickets are on sale now. For more information where each film is being shown, be sure to visit julianfilmfest.com or their Facebook and Twitter accounts.
And that's all the time we have for you tonight.
Check back for additional content on myduhawk.com and catch Sports Zone next week at 7 p.m.
Have a great night.